We've had three discussions on the Holy Spirit, on the promise of the coming Holy Spirit. And so I just want to take a minute and review and kind of tie all of those together and then take it a step farther today. In our first little talk on the Spirit, we call that Epics of the Spirit, Eras of the Spirit, if you will, or Epics of the Spirit. He says that the story begins and God is dwelling with His people, and the story ends and God is dwelling with His people. That's what we see in the first two chapters of the Bible and in the last two chapters of the Bible. In the in-between time, though, there's something that we know as the fall, and at the fall, when Adam and Eve sinned, that intimacy between God and man was broken, but God didn't give up, and He begins to act in redemptive ways, progressively dwelling closer and closer to His people. And so He dwells in the tabernacle, if you remember, with the children of Israel as they're in the wilderness. His glory comes down, His Spirit comes down and fills the tabernacle. And then later, His glory, His presence, His Spirit fills the temple. And then at the exile, all this is Old Testament stuff, at the exile, when God's people are carried into the Babylonian exile, away from their homeland, if you remember, the prophet, in particular Ezekiel, sees a vision of the glory, the very presence of God departing from the temple. And for a long and dry and dark and dreary period in history, there is no authoritative, prophetic, Holy Spirit-inspired voice speaking to the people. It's not that God isn't active. History is replete. Biblical history, intertestamental history, the history between the Old Testament and the New Testament, it is full of God's activity with His people. But there are no authoritative voices inspired by the Spirit speaking and working in that way. And then on the scene comes Jesus, and He begins walking around, filled with the Holy Spirit, usurping the function of the temple that is essentially void of the Spirit. And He gathers the group around Him, and then He gets ready to go back to heaven. And He says, now I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and He's going to fill you. He's going to fill anyone who would call on the name of the Lord. And the Spirit is now given to live inside of us in these mobile tents, in these tabernacles that we call our bodies. So that's how the Spirit has worked in redemptive history. Then a couple of weeks ago for Mother's Day, we wrapped the Holy Spirit's work up in this whole idea of the beauty of contrast. That's what the sermon was called. And we said that men and women are created equal in the image of God, but they're created with contrast, regardless of what the world tries to say today. Men and women are different. God created them with these contrasts. But by the Holy Spirit, God used those contrasts to confirm and to affirm women, to fill them with power for life and for service right alongside men, and sometimes vice versa. And what I mean by that is sometimes the men served alongside the women. And all of that is due to the power of the Holy Spirit, bringing out those contrasts, elevating women, affirming and confirming them in God's whole big plan of redemptive history. He's saying men and with all of your context, leave. The Holy Spirit wants me just to stand up, and I want to confirm, and I want to affirm it. And that's relevant to us today because for so long, and in so many cultures, that's just not how things are. But from a biblical perspective, women are elevated to prominence equal with men. Yes, with contrast. Yes, different roles. All of those things don't mean that they can't be equal because they're created equal in the image of God. And then last week we talked about the work of the Spirit, and we just did an overview, and we just blasted through a whole bunch of things. We said that by His power, He works in us. He shows us Christ. He shows us our sin. He shows us His solution to sin. He gives us faith. He gives us repentance. He makes in our lives all things new. He gives us life. He seals us. And He assures us that we are children of God. He gives us gifts. He guides us. He helps us. He prays for us when we don't know how to pray. He teaches us. He makes Jesus real to us. And He produces fruit in our lives. And today I want to take it a step farther, and I want to say that He also fills us, both initially and subsequently. Initially and after that, subsequently. So, the question becomes, if you stop and think about it for a second, if the Holy Spirit, if He is already in us, aren't we already full of the Spirit? And the answer is yes, but the answer is also no. And that's what we're going to explore today. The same Spirit that has filled us when we put our faith in Jesus now invites us to allow Him to fill us more and more and more. And it seems to not make sense because if we're already full, how could we be any more full? So, I'm probably going to confuse you at first, but hang in there. I hope to create some dissatisfaction in you so that in the process, I can make this more clear to you and actually give me something like 30 minutes or so to talk about all of this stuff on. Otherwise, I could be done right now and we could move on. We could go to lunch. It's a little early, but hey, we could do it. So, please, track with me over the next few minutes, and I want to explain to us what the Bible talks about when it says that we're filled with the Spirit, and yet there's more Spirit to fill us with. Not really more Spirit to fill us with, but that actually we have the potential to be more filled than we know. And so we're going to take that additional step, and over beginning today and over the next few weeks, some of the things that we're going to talk about, not everybody agrees on. So it's a little controversial. I am going to be as biblical as I know how to be in all of this. Because when we come to the Scriptures, we all come to it with certain preconceived notions about what it says. And then what we do is we read those preconceived notions into the Scripture to make it say what we think that it already says. It's my job as your pastor to strip all of that away and to say, this is what the Word says, and this is how we're to understand it. Because that's how it was written to be understood. It's not what everybody else thinks. It's how did God intend it to be understood. And that's what I want to do today. So, yeah, we may not all agree on everything, but you know what? The Word of God is big, and sometimes it's a little fuzzy, and that's okay. But we're going to address these issues anyway, and we're going to see how that plays these things out in the midst of a congregation. And to do that, I want to begin by introducing a couple of terms among many about the Holy Spirit's work. And good people disagree on this, okay? Good Bible-believing people disagree on this. But I just want to be clear and make it clear to you, and I think I have, on my intent. And I want to begin by talking about these two terms. The first one is baptized in the Spirit, and the second one is filled with the Spirit. And I want to look at several scriptures, and then I want to land in Ephesians chapter 5, and both of these terms, being baptized in the Spirit and being filled with the Spirit, are used in reference to the coming of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost that we read about in Acts chapter 2. Both of them are used of that one single event. So I want to make it some comments that will distinguish those two terms, and then we'll move on and we'll talk about what it means to be filled with the Spirit. So, I'm just going to give you the reference, and then I'll tell you what it says, so we can move right through these first few scriptures. Okay, so there's this long, dry period where the Spirit is not evidently working in men like He has, like we've seen Him work in the Old Testament. And along comes this guy named John the Baptist, and Luke records, along with the other gospel writers, the story of John the Baptist, the greatest of all of the Old Testament prophets, now appears in the pages of the New Testament. But by the way, Jesus hasn't died and been resurrected yet, so it's still Old Testament. Here comes the greatest of all of the Old Testament prophets, John, and the Spirit is all over this guy, and he's speaking, and all of the people are anticipating the coming of the Messiah, and they ask him in Luke chapter 3, verses 15 and 16, "Hey, are you the Messiah?" And he says, "No, I'm not the Messiah. I baptize you in water, but the one coming after me, whose sandals I'm not worthy to untie, he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." Sneaking in there, and we forget about this, in John chapter 20, verse 22, when Jesus, on the last night of his earthly life, is addressing his disciples, he breathes on them and he says, "Receive the Holy Spirit." At that moment, the Holy Spirit takes up residence in his disciples. Now, Luke continues, just to cut that away for a second, Luke continues to write in the book of Acts, because remember, Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke in Acts. Luke writes in 1:5, "Well, John baptized with water," right? We heard about that. "But in a few days," and this is Jesus talking, "you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit." Baptized in the Holy Spirit. Baptized in the Holy Spirit. In Acts chapter 2, verse 4, the terminology changes. And it says that all of them, on the day of Pentecost, all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit. So, it was described in Acts chapter 1 as being baptized, but in Acts chapter 2, that same experience is described as being filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. So, we have these two terms used to describe the same event, it seems like. And then when we get to Paul, he uses this idea of baptized, not in a different way, but he begins to apply it to the church. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 13, he says, "For we are all baptized by one Spirit, so we form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we are all given one Spirit to drink. So we're baptized, but at the same time, we're filled." So how do you understand those two terms? So let me just clarify, because we'll go on and we'll talk about being baptized in the Spirit, and we'll use it differently than we're going to be using being filled with the Spirit. So baptism seems to me to be more of a description. It's the initiation out of something and the immersion into something new. Okay, that makes sense, like baptism. You're baptized out of your old life and you're raised to something new, new life in Christ. So, baptism speaks of a life in Christ, a new life in the Spirit, now active in us, now empowering us, now working in us. Like the disciples, John chapter 20, Jesus breathed on them and said, "Receive the Spirit." The Spirit was already in their life. Okay, but then He comes in power and He baptizes them at one moment in time. It's almost a description of what happened. Now it's even more full in your life, even though you were already full. So that brings me to the term, I hope you're confused by now. So I really want to confuse you and then I want to clear it up, okay? Full seems to be more of a dynamic. So baptism is like a static thing, so one time kind of thing. Filled is a dynamic. And it speaks to this idea of an active ever-increasing measure to be full of what you're already full of. And so it addresses this idea of substance. You're full. But there's more to fill you with, or there's more in you to be filled. So they have the Spirit, and they're full of the Spirit. And on the day of Pentecost, it becomes very obvious that they're full of the Spirit. And it was not like there was more Spirit for them to receive. They had received all of the Spirit that they could receive. And so how in the world could they be filled anymore? And you say, so what's up with all of this? I mean, maybe you read the scriptures and you read right over this and you don't even think anything about it. So I challenge you. Challenge the scripture. Dig into the scripture. See those distinctions and understand more fully what they mean. Don't just depend on me. So we have these two points. Baptized in the Spirit and filled in the Spirit. And as I said, like in 1 Corinthians, when Paul begins to talk about the gift of the Spirit in chapter 12, he uses the term, a more static term, of being baptized in the Spirit. But then he goes on to use the term in Ephesians chapter 5, and that's our text for today. And that's what Paul calls being filled with the Spirit. So Paul uses baptized in the Spirit more as a one-time event. You're baptized into the body. When you receive Christ, the Holy Spirit comes in, the Holy Spirit fills your life, and that is your Spirit baptism into the body of Christ. And you're full of the Spirit. But then Paul goes on to talk to his churches about, now that you're filled, be filled. So we need to understand, I think, what that means, this subsequent filling, because Paul uses it in reference to the growth of the individual, the believer, in the life and the things of the Spirit. And so I want to read the context, and then I'm going to go back and look at the command. Ephesians chapter 5. I'm not even off my first page of notes, and I've already lost it. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 15 is where I'm going to begin, and I'm going to read the verse 21. This is what Paul says to the Ephesian believers. Be very careful, then, how you live. Not as unwise, but wise. Verse 15. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Verse 17. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is. And here's our command. Verse 18. Do not get drunk on wine. I'm probably going to say, don't be drunk with wine, because that's how I memorized it. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery, and we all know what debauchery is, right? Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Verse 19. Speaking to one another in psalms and hymns and songs of the Spirit with spiritual songs. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now I have a whole new paragraph and I have a whole new heading. But this next part dramatically fits with what I just read. And he goes on to say, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. So this is all one thing. Don't get drunk with wine, be filled with the Spirit, and then all of these things will follow all the way down to submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. And so now I want to go back to verse 18, and I want to look at the command specifically. Look at the context. Now let's look at the command to be filled with the Spirit. And notice, interestingly, it's tied with being drunk on wine. Now, why do you suppose that Paul would have to tell the church or churches in the first century not to be drunk with wine? Because they were getting drunk on wine. See, when they had communion, this crazy thing happened, and Paul has to address it because it's so prevalent in the Corinthian church. In 1 Corinthians, Paul has to write to them And he has to address this very issue because when they took communion, it was a full-blown meal, and people weren't drinking grape juice. They were drinking wine. They were abusing the Lord's Supper, and they were becoming drunk. When they celebrated the Lord's Supper, they were using real wine, and they were getting tipsy and maybe even drunk. And there was no church manual when this whole thing got off the ground. It's like, how do you do church? And we read the pages of the New Testament, we actually find there are lots of different ways to do church. So if you ever wonder why there's lots of different churches, stop blaming your own denominationalism and all that kind of stuff. There's always been churches that conduct themselves differently. God has made room in His sovereignty for all of that. So there's no manual to get this thing off the ground. So, a little bit of background, what you have here, because there was no church background, is that you have Jewish people, along with some Gentile people in churches, and they're just going about doing their church thing, but because they're Jewish, they were raised up in synagogue and temple worship, so when they do church, they pattern it after what they already know. Synagogue and temple worship. Then you also have, like the Ephesian believers, you have non-Jewish people who have come to Jesus, and one of the basic association groups that they knew of at the time was called the Symposia. That's plural. And these were Greek and Roman professional associations that were held in homes. And very often they would include horse joking, sexual immorality, and lots of drinking. And so it's very interesting that when Paul writes to this Gentile church in the city of Ephesus, that he addresses these things. He says, hey, stop the horse joking, quit the sexual immorality, and don't get drunk on wine. You see, there's a reason why Paul is writing this, because apparently that's what was happening in the church. Because these were primarily non-Jewish people, and they were simply patterning this meeting, their church meetings, after what they already knew to be the way that things should be when people get together in these professional organizations known as the Symposia, or Symposium. So he has to write to them because this is what non-Jewish people do. And by the way, in the Jewish mind, there's only Jews and non-Jews. You ever seen my book, That Greek Wedding, like there's Greek and non-Greek, that's all there is, right? Well, to the Jews, that's all there is. And by the way, apparently maybe that's the way it is to God, too. There's Jews and there's non-Jews, which would be Greek and Roman. And so they're just patterning their church experience after what they already know from the professional associations that they have probably been part of their whole life. So Paul has to write to them, and he has to say, hey, don't be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. And so you have to ask yourself, are these people who are believers already filled with the Spirit? And the answer is yes. And Paul addresses that as we read through the book. Track with you, Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13. He says, having believed, past tense, talking to the Ephesians. 1:13, having believed, you were marked with the seal, the promised Holy Spirit. In Ephesians 2:22, Paul says, you are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by His Holy Spirit. So these are people who have received fully the Spirit. These are people who have been baptized from their former lifestyle now to be immersed in a whole new lifestyle. The problem is they're carrying on their old lifestyle in their church services. So Paul has to write to them, and he has to say, hey, you need to be immersed in the life of Christ, in the life of the Spirit. I know it's already active in you because you believe. I know it's already working powerfully in you because you believe. But there's more. There's a promise of more. More fullness for you. And that's the commandment. They have all of the Spirit. Now he says, be filled with the Spirit. And so why did he issue that command? And I think I've started to make it plain a little bit more now, like you have the Spirit. But now he says, be filled with the Spirit. They're filled with the Spirit. Why would he say, And you have to think about it, they're trying to work through this too. How many of you, like, filled with the Spirit, like we've been baptized? So what's the deal? So you have to answer the question. And to answer that question, let me give you just a few more minutes of painful background, and we're going to talk about this idea of healing. If we get, again, look at the book of Ephesians, this is what we see. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. Paul prays that they may be filled to the full measure of the fullness of God. Now, do they already have God? Yes. So why did he pray this? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13. Paul is talking about the unity of the faith and the gift so that they might attain to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Now, do they already have Christ? So what's this whole full measure about? And then when we get to our text, Ephesians 5:18, he says, hey, don't get drunk on wine, but be filled rather with the Spirit. And this is our problem. We read that, and we try to make something out of it when we haven't taken the time to go back and read the whole book, because we just don't do that. And we don't catch the flow of what Paul is trying to say. Paul is saying, hey, you have God, now be filled with the fullness of God. Hey, you have Jesus, you have Christ, now be filled with the fullness of Christ. And then he says, hey, you have the Spirit, now be filled with the fullness of the Spirit. That's the command. Paul is saying that they should be filled with what they're already full of. Why would he say that? Paul does this all the time. He says things like, you're holy, so be holy. He says, your old self is dead, so kill it. How can you kill it if it's dead? How can you be holy if you're already holy? And it's because that we are not only already, but not yet, type people. There are certain things that are already true of us, but not yet. We are also both in, not either or people. We can be both full, and yet we can be filled. So take that little tone. You might hear me say it a few times. Take that little tone and tuck it away in the back of your mind, because that's how the scriptures present us. And that answers so many questions. We're already, but not yet, but we're also not either or, but we're both in. We're full, but we can be more full. So let me give you the analogy of marriage. I'm just going to drive this point home now. I was pronounced a husband, and then I was invited to learn what it's like to be a husband, right? So you could say I was invited to be what was already true of me. I was declared a husband on my wedding day, but I didn't have the foggiest idea. I'm not sure that I even did. I was invited on my wedding day to be something that I already was, and I didn't have the foggiest idea of what that meant. So the invitation of marriage is to become a husband, even though I was already a husband. So, what Paul is saying, by virtue of Christ, for instance, you are holy, so Paul would say, be holy. Your old self is dead, so kill it. It's an invitation. You are full of the Holy Spirit, so be filled. We are people in process. But by virtue of our union with Christ, what is true of Jesus is true of us. So become what you already are. And Jesus was full of the Spirit. So the invitation is to be full of the Spirit of Christ. And if you're still not clear, let me throw some Greek at you, and this ought to clear it all up for sure. You go back and read real quick so you're thinking out a second. Catch up with you. So, my brain is a second. Ephesians chapter 5, again, we're going to start this time with this. And you can read these things. Do not get drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another in psalms, hymns, and songs of the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and then submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Now, in English, that makes sense, but I want to tell you a little bit about this command to be filled in Greek. Okay, I wish I had a PowerPoint for this, but I don't, so you're going to have to listen carefully, track with me here. So we're going to talk about this command to be filled in Greek. First of all, it's in the imperative mood. Now, if you're like me, when I took a foreign language, I learned way more about the English language than I ever did in all of my English classes. This is the imperative mood to be filled is presented in by Paul. An imperative mood is a command to do something, to be filled. You be filled. It's in the plural form, which is interesting. That means that it's written to a community. When Paul is writing it, he's writing it to the church, which was quite a community, by the way. Historians say about 50,000 people met in Ephesus in church homes all over the city. It was a handful to manage. No wonder Paul told Timothy, take some wine for your stomach's sake. Because Timothy was the pastor over that church. It's in the plural form, so it's written to a community. And so, in case you're wondering, it's written to the church. And one of the worst things that we can do when we read the Bible is we can read it as if it's written to us, individually. When so much of the New Testament, especially when you get to the epistles, the letters to the churches, so much of the New Testament is written to churches to be worked out in the community. Imperative, plural form, written to a community. Now, let me give you an example from the same book, from the book of Ephesians. If you don't have to turn there, but if you go to the sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians, what you find is this idea of the whole armor of God. Paul tells them, put on the whole armor of God, right? And so you go to a Christian bookstore, and I don't know if I've ever had, but I think you can probably find something there. You go to a Christian bookstore, and you find individual pieces of armor as if you were supposed to put those things on all by yourself. When the command is written to a church, we work these things out in community. We need a community to work out the fullness of the Spirit in our lives. So many of the yous in Scripture are plural, meaning they're written to churches. They're written to groups of people. That's the plural form here. So Paul is writing this to more than one person. He's writing it to the church. And embedded in New Testament Greek, and it doesn't come out in English, is that you actually need other people to work this out. So you could read the command in this way. Church, don't get drunk. Church, be filled with the Spirit. We read commands like this and we think individual first, then community second. Paul reverses all of that. And he says, community first, and individual second. Because he knows we all need to do this together. The Christian faith is much more about community than it is about being individuals. And I know that rubs us the wrong way in a culture that almost deifies, it definitely elevates individuality. Right? Everything in our life has told us, as Americans, that we are individuals. And we have rights and all this kind of stuff. But when you look at the New Testament, when you look at the whole Bible, it's really about community. So this command is for the whole community. Of course, individuals are to be filled, but the command is for the church to be filled because it takes us working this out in real life together as a community. And this is true within the proper church. Well, you're getting a Greek lesson. You didn't come to church expecting that today, did you? It's a command, and this is rare in the New Testament. There's only a couple of them in the New Testament. Most of them are do this or don't do that. It's in the passive voice, which means that it's a command to let something be done to you. The command is allow yourself to be filled with the Spirit. I mean, you still have a part to play. Can you fill yourself with spirit? No, not even remotely. What's your job? What's my job? To cultivate an openness to be filled. To take a posture of the heart that allows the spirit to come in, even though we're filled, and fill us even more. And this is critical because we don't fill ourselves. We have to allow ourselves to be filled. And then we cultivate. We have to prepare in order for this to happen. The posture of our heart that actually allows that to take place, that actually allows Christ, who, by the way, is the baptizer, to fill us more and more. And it's community for us. And individual. And then, lastly, it's in the past tense. Which means, in this case, it is an ongoing reality, not a one-time event, which sounds a little bit more like baptism, right? You're baptized into the body. That happens. That happens once, right? This is something that takes place in the past, but it's still ongoing. It's not a one-time event. That's how, in this instance, the past tense is used. So, the command is, go on being filled, or as some have said, be ye being filled. It's continuous, and it's a present imperative. It's a command to do it and to keep on doing it. So the posture of churches and individuals is one that cultivates, one that invites, right, the Spirit to fill us in an ongoing way. That's what Paul is saying. We're full, but now we position our hearts so that we can be filled more and more in an ongoing way. And we're almost done with the Greek here. Let me just really quickly give you the five present participles that indicate what happens when a church is filled and being filled with the Holy Spirit. And these aren't spooky or strange or anything like that, okay? We find them, actually, in the text. This is what will happen when the church is filled. We will begin to relate to God with one another in all new ways, and it won't look anything like the symposium. It will be completely different. What does Paul say will happen? Verse 19. We will speak, we will sing, we will make music, we will give thanks, and we will submit. Those are the five present participles. Verse 19. We will be speaking to one another with psalms and hymns and songs that the Spirit will sing and will make music in our hearts. We'll always be giving thanks to God the Father in everything, and in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And then we will also submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And it doesn't mean that all we do is talk about religious things, okay? And we get all, you know, spiritual about everything on all of this stuff. But rather it means that what we do because we're filled with the Spirit is we make those expressions full of joy, full of thankfulness. The things that we say, the way that we act will be an encouragement, and we will honor others and not tear others down. When we are filled with the Spirit, that's what happens. The Spirit will fill us to the point where it bubbles over. And I think that that's something that we would want to be a part of, wouldn't you? To be filled with the Spirit to the point where we speak, we sing, we make music, we give thanks, and we submit to one another. So, let me give you a recap before I wrap this up. So, Paul looks at the church and he says, don't get drunk on wine, but be filled with the Spirit. I was married on my wedding day, but there's not more of him out there for me to marry. I mean, I've got her. Most days, she's got me. But we've got each other. How's that? I got you, babe. With you, she may be in the nursery. Yeah, she's in the nursery, so she can hear that crazy word. But, so, I'm married, and every day I'm trying to live in the fullness of that, right? But I don't get any more of him. I already have all of him. But I don't live in the fullness of that on the first day. Absolutely not. And for those of you who may have been married hundreds of years, like Pam and I, there's never a place that you get where you say, hey, I got it. I'm all the way full. There's no more to get. It's always ongoing, growing, learning. And so, you're married now. The scripture would say, if it did, live in the fullness of your marriage. But scripture does explicitly say, you are filled with the Spirit, now be filled more and more and more and more with the fullness of the Spirit. What does that mean? It's a command to let something happen to you, and evidently you can resist, and evidently you can cultivate, you can invite into your heart, you can take the position that will actually allow the Spirit to fill you, even though you're completely full. Am I making sense? Are you following? I haven't said anything that I didn't say like in the first 2 minutes. That's just summarizing. Let me give you one more analogy. In case there's someone here that hasn't quite grasped it yet. This comes from systematic work by Wayne Grudem on my desk right now. And I was thinking about actually illustrating this, but I knew that I would run out of time, so I decided just to read it. Here's the analogy. Someone might object that a person who is already full of the Holy Spirit cannot become more full. If a glass is full of water, no more water can be put into it, right? If a glass is full of water, you can't put any more water into it. Actually, you think there's a little bit of light in here. Something that holds it all together. Yeah, you can see it, whatever. Yeah, you know that. But if a glass is full, for our sake, the glass is full, you can't put any more water in it, right? But a water glass is a poor analogy for real people. For God is able to cause us to grow and to be able to contain much more of the Holy Spirit's power and fullness. A better analogy, not the glass, a better analogy might be the balloon, which can be full of air, even though very little air is in it. Right? If I had a balloon, I could blow it up that much, and it would be full of air. So this is what he's saying. When more air is blown in, that balloon expands, and in a sense, it is more full, right? That's what's being addressed here. So it is with us. We can be filled with the Holy Spirit, and at the same time, be able to receive much more of the Holy Spirit. Well, you see, we're not doing it. We're both in it. We're also already, but not yet. God is always working on us. So the image is not of some static container. That's a poor illustration of what we're like. Okay? The glass. It's more like a balloon where you could be fuller and fuller and fuller. And so, what we're to do is we're to cultivate the progressive and dynamic, ongoing openness to the person and the work of the Spirit. And the invitation is that you live into that. You live into that fullness of the Spirit in ever-increasing measure, and more, and more. And so, it's not something that God does to you externally, but rather it's something that God does in you, and then it bubbles over in your life, and you become fuller and fuller and fuller. So now the question changes. If I'm full, how can I be more full? So how do I like this God? And it's tricky, not really, but you know, we'll say that it's tricky. It's easier said than done. That's the question we're invited to work through. How do we allow this to happen? It's an invitation to cultivate an internal environment where the Spirit can fill us more and more fully. How do we do this? And there seems to be three postures of the heart. Okay, these are not steps. It's not like you go to a furniture, you know, one of these office stores or IKEA or something, and you get some steps and you put things together, you know, you buy a desk or whatever it is, or a piece of furniture, and you put it together, and you call it 1, 2, 3, and when you're done, you have a piece of furniture. It's not like you can do these things 1, 2, 3, and all of a sudden you're just like Jesus. It's not like that at all. These things are much more dynamic, and they have to be worked out in community, in our lives, ongoing, regularly, over and over and over. So it's not steps, okay? I want to make that clear. These are not steps. These are ongoing postures of the heart that opens us up for more and more fullness of the Spirit. And the first one is this, expectancy.
And what that means is you just take God at His word. Whatever God says, you believe it's true. Not without warrant, but you come to the place in your faith that you know when God speaks, you can believe it. He said that He would do this. I mean, the writer of Hebrews kind of gets at it a bit when he says anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who honestly seek Him right. If you seek God, if you expect something from God and you're seeking God, you have to take Him at His word. So if you're seeking to be filled and He has already commanded us to be being filled, then what would make you think that He wouldn't fill you if you're coming to Him expecting to be filled? It's believing God that He will actually do what He said that He would do. You may not feel it, and you may not know it, but that doesn't mean that it wouldn't happen. Because we're always looking for the feeling, right? And we put the feeling over the reality of it. God does things in our lives, and we don't even have a clue. Would you agree? Yeah, could God fill you, and you not feel it at the moment, but all of a sudden find yourself full of joy and thankfulness and gratefulness and honoring one another, and all of a sudden when you're speaking to people in the church and out of the church, there's this overflow of the Spirit, and you find yourself way more gracious than you know that you are in your heart. You never felt it, but you're experiencing it because it's real in your life. Because when you ask, you expect it, and God fills you. God, I do believe You will do just what You said You would do. You will do. Now, you may ask, pray, Lord, help my unbelief. But nevertheless, you ask and you believe. That's the expectancy. Think about the disciples, Acts 1:8. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And then they had to wait. I mean, they had spent a lifetime looking for the Messiah. They find Him. They walk around Him for 3.5 years. He says all kinds of things, more baffling than what I say to you, hopefully. And then they have to wait 10 more days, but they did it expectantly. They believed Jesus. They took Him at His word, and they went to Jerusalem, and they waited. And boy, when God filled them, did He fill them ever. We're still talking about it today. Because they went expecting. And then, the second posture of the heart is this. Create space. Go expectant. Create space. Orient your life around all of this. Orient your life around God. Orient your life around Jesus. God seems to be a respecter of human dignity. Would you agree? You reject Him? You reject Him. You got one another. That's why James says, draw near to God, and He'll draw near to you. And then, if you have a bunch of junk in your life, you're acting ugly, He says, wash your hands in submission, purify your heart. He says, get the junk out of your life to make room so that you can orient now your life. You can create space in your life, in your heart, so that the Spirit can come in and live. And the primary way that we begin that whole process of orienting our life around Him, we expect and then we orient our life. How do we begin that process? By asking. Ask, seek, and knock, right? Isn't that what Scripture says? The primary way we do it is we ask. But it's not just, Lord, fill me, fill me, fill me. It's that we orient, we yield our life, we submit our life, and we say things like, not your will, no, not my will, but Your will be done in my life. Let Your will be done in my life, and then you expect. So you come expectantly, and then you yield. You create space for God, and you ask Him to fill you. And then you continue to ask Him to fill you as you orient your life again. Think about the disciples. Go back to them, because Acts 1 and 2, that's been our text for this whole series, right? And this is where they get the promise of the Father, the gift of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, Acts chapter 1, Acts chapter 2, the filling of the Spirit. But for all this time, the disciples have shaped their lives by Acts chapter 1 around this Jesus, and now He's leaving, and they go to Jerusalem, and they have to wait 10 more days. And while they're waiting, what are they doing? They're praying, right? And what are they doing while they're praying? They're asking for the promise of the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus told them to do. So they go to Jerusalem. They don't know it's going to be 10 days. They don't know how long it's going to be. But they go expecting that what Jesus said is going to happen, it's going to happen. They don't know what it's going to be like, but they go anyway, and for 10 days, they pray for the promised Holy Spirit, and when God fills them, boy, does He fill them. Third posture of the heart. This involves confession and repentance, and it has to do with our own obedience. So you're living a lifestyle of obedience, and when we don't obey, we confess, right? We repent. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, written to believers. But when we're not living a lifestyle of the Spirit, of obedience, so obedience is number 3, by the way. When we're living a lifestyle of greed or deceit or whatever it is, we say, where's the intimacy? Where's the power? Where's the guilt? And Scripture takes us right back to offenses, which we're going to talk about tonight. Takes us right back to offenses against the Spirit. When we exert our will and override the counsel and promptings of the Spirit, we receive our own reward. And it's not filling with the Spirit where we find ourselves joyful and thankful and encouraging and considering others. What we're doing is we're actually filling our lives with things that oppose the work of the Spirit, the very one who gives us life in the first place. And we die a thousand deaths, and we end up empty, not full. But the Spirit has been given to empower us to live the life that Jesus lived. The other way is empty, that Jesus gives us full. We're obedient. Is it the life? In other words, as the Spirit works in us, it becomes more and more of the life. So, as we do less and less of the Lord. And as we do that, what we find is it blows open our capacity. It expands like a balloon, our capacity for the Spirit to come in and fill us more and more and more. I'm a husband, but I'm learning what it is to be a wife. I'm still a wife. And when I'm watching the demons, the door is open wide for the Spirit to come in and fill me more and more and more. And the disciples went to Jerusalem, and they waited in obedience and prayer, and no doubt. And the Lord filled them and filled them so full. Every analogy breaks down something, right? I believe in prophecy put it up earlier, right? The Spirit filled them so full that it started to come out of their mouth and spilled out into the street and it spilled out of Jerusalem and it spilled into Judea and Samaria and everywhere else. And this promise is for you and for your children and for your children's children and for as many as are far off all the way down to us today. He has filled us and He will continue as long as we create postures in our heart that would be receptive to that. He will fill us in the same way today. If we will open our hearts for the filling of the Spirit, even though we're already full, He will fill us to measures beyond what we can even comprehend. So that we will have that joy, so that we will sing songs, so that we will be thankful, so that rather than tearing other people down, we'll build them up. We will submit out of reverence for Christ, who was God and came to this earth, took on human form, laid down His life on our behalf. That's what we do. A Spirit-filled church is not about a bunch of hopping around. It's about laying down our life for the people in our community. That's what the Spirit-filled church looks like. When our hearts are right before God and the Spirit is filling us in ever-increasing ways, then love, joy, peace, and love is over. And we just continue. And it becomes continued to those things. Have you ever run into somebody that you wish you hadn't run into? You see them at the store and you go the other way because you know if you're talking to them, they're going to train you or whatever, you're going to do. But then, have you ever seen someone that you just get excited to talk to them because you need pumped up, filled up, full of life because they're exuding that very thing and it's contagious? So, this is what we're going to do. Rob, come on up. This is what we're going to do. Because the command is plural, because it's to a community, because it's to a church, we're going to do this as a church. We're going to sing along with Rob. Just do the song, Rob, even if it's just one verse in the chorus. We're going to sing, and we're going to begin to allow an expectancy to be created in our own hearts.
Why are you striving?
Why are you striving these days? Why are you trying to earn grace? Why are you crying? Let me lift up your face. Just don't turn away. Why are you looking for love? Why are you still searching as if I'm not enough? To where will you go, child? Tell me, where will you run? To where will you run? Cause I'll be by your side wherever you fall in the dead of night. Whenever you call and please don't fight. These hands that are holding you, yeah, my hands are holding. I'll be by your side wherever you fall in the dead of night. Whenever you call and please don't fight. These hands that are holding. Look at these hands and my side. They swallowed the grave on that night. When I drank the world's sin so I could carry you in and give you life. I wanna give you life. 'Cause I'll be by your side wherever you fall, in the dead of night, whenever you call it.